Praise the Lord. I welcome you to the Bible study tonight. And I pray that the word will enrich every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for our Bible study. Thank you for the faithfulness of your people. Thank you for our brothers, our sisters, mothers, fathers, young and old. We thank you for the Bible study. We thank you for the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ that has provided everything for us, reconciliation, righteousness, redemption, and everything. We're asking, O Lord, that the benefits of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ will be ours, one and all, in Jesus' name. Be with us as we study tonight, and we pray that your spirit will take the word that is read and the word that is spoken, apply it to every heart, that we will be stronger in our conviction of what you are revealing to us in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight we come to an important study which runs through actually the whole of the New Testament. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is very important. And the disciples needed the appearances of Christ after he rose from the dead. That's why today we're coming to Mark chapter 16 and we're looking at verse 9. Mark chapter 16 from verse 9. It says, now, when Jesus was risen early, the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. I want you to underline the word there, appeared. And look at verse 12. As you look at verse 12, it tells us, after that, he appeared in another form unto two of them as they walked and went into the country. That word appears again, appeared. And then as we look at verse 14, in verse 14 it tells us, and afterward he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. You'll find the word appeared, appeared, appeared three times in that short passage, telling us that Christ actually appeared to his own disciples in his risen form, glorified body. They didn't believe at the beginning. They had hardness of heart. It was hard for them to believe. But then as Jesus appeared unto them with many infallible proofs, then they knew actually that Christ was risen. And it was easy for them. It was normal for them to then go through all the things they went through, declaring that Jesus Christ had risen from the dead. I know you believe as a child of God. I know you believe as a reader and as a student of the Bible that Jesus rose from the dead. But all the same, we're going to follow through on this word, appeared, appeared. That is, the resurrected Christ, the risen Christ, appeared unto his own disciples. We've seen it already in Mark chapter 16, verse 9, verse 12, and verse 14. I want you to look at Luke chapter 24. In Luke chapter 24, we're looking at verse 32. Luke chapter 24, and we're reading from verse 32. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures? And then in verse 33, it tells us, and they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 gathered together and them that were with them. Look at verse 34 now. In verse 34, saying, the Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. That's the word appeared again. They said, the Lord has risen. Not only that, you know, they just said the Lord had risen. They said, the Lord had risen indeed, in truth, in reality. The Lord had risen. Not only that, he appeared to Simon. It tells us in Acts of the Apostles chapter 1, reading from verse 2. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1, we're looking at verse 2, telling us that when Christ rose from the dead, it's not just that they suppose he rose from the dead, he actually appeared unto them. In fact, in this Acts chapter 1, look at verse 2 and notice what it says, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. Verse 3 now tells us in verse 3, it says to whom also he showed himself, and that's the same thing as saying he appeared himself, he appeared to them, he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs. Underline those three words, actually many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. No doubt, Jesus rose from the dead, and he appeared unto his own disciples. He appeared even unto Paul later in Acts chapter 9, and then Peter emphasized and reminded the people in the house of Cornelius that Jesus rose from the dead, and he appeared unto them. As you come to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 4, the same emphasis you are going to find, that Jesus Christ actually, after he rose from the dead, he appeared to his own disciples. It says in verse 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures. Then in verse 5, it says, after he said he rose again, now it says, and he was seen of Cephas, that is, was seen of Peter, then of the 12, and then it comes to verse 6. It says in verse 6, after that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present day, unto this present, but some are falling asleep. And then he tells us in verse 7, he assures us, after that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. And Paul is going to talk about himself now in verse 8. He says in verse 8, and at last, and last of all, he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. We have gone through all this for you to understand the resurrection of Christ is central. That resurrection of Christ is pivotal. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is foundational as well as fundamental to the gospel of our salvation. The apostles were so sure of it that they were willing to give their lives to seal their testimony. And you should be sure about the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you declare anywhere and everywhere that Jesus actually rose from the dead. There are three points we're going to consider as we look at the message today. Number one, the remarkable appearances of the risen Christ. Remarkable. It says the remarkable appearances of the risen Christ. Number two is the restorative appearances of the risen Christ. What does that mean? That the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ actually restored them, restored their confidence, restored their faith, restored their conviction. That resurrection of Jesus Christ, as the Lord appeared unto them, they were of doubtful mind before the appearance. They were kind of having hardness of heart before the appearance. The appearance of the Lord Jesus Christ after he rose from the dead restored them. Conviction restored. faith restored and passion restored. Everything, their hope was restored. Everything they had in their mind, everything was restored. The restorative appearances of the risen Christ. Number three is the regenerating appearance of the risen Christ. That appearance of the Lord Jesus Christ after he rose from the dead, that's what brought repentance from Saul that became Paul the Apostle. That's what brought his reconciliation with God. That's what brought his turning around, and that's what brought the regeneration, the salvation, the conversion of Paul the Apostle. That's the regenerating appearance of the risen Christ. Let's come back to point number one. Point number one is the remarkable appearances of the risen Christ. The remarkable appearances of the risen Christ. We're looking at Mark chapter 16, verses 9 and 10. Mark chapter 16, verse 9. Now, when Jesus was risen early, the first day of the week. Mark that your Bible. He was risen the first day of the week. And that means our salvation is now real. Our justification is now real. That's the reason why we celebrate that resurrection on the first day of the week. Some people might wonder, why don't we worship on the Sabbath day? Why don't we worship on Saturday? You understand? The Sabbath day was given to the children of Israel to remember their own redemption, to remember their coming out, their deliverance, coming out of the captivity of Egypt. But in our own case, on the first day of the week, Jesus rose from the dead, and then our salvation, our justification, our redemption, our reconciliation with God, and the blessings of Calvary became ours. Because if he did not rise from the dead, our faith will be vain. Our salvation will not be real. And there will not be the connection between us and getting to heaven. It was because of that resurrection on the first day of the week. Now we can celebrate our redemption, our salvation, our justification. That's why we're not going back to the old covenant and then go back under the bondage of the law, that because we were not in Egypt, we were in sin, and the Lord delivered us. Now we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. On the first day of the week, he rose up, and yet I appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven spirits. It tells us in verse 10, it says, and she went, and he told them that had been with him as they mourned and wept. You see, the word of God affirms that the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is real. Heaven and earth testified to the resurrection of Christ. You remember what we have read in the first part of Mark chapter 16, that Mary saw the angel. An angel rolled away the stone. A great earthquake terrified those keepers at the tomb. And the chief priests who bribed the guests, they knew of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. The angel declared, he is risen. He is risen. He is not here. That tells us then that the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is something very definite, as everything was affirmed. In fact, that risen Christ appeared to Mary now, as we have read. He appeared to the two disciples on their way to Emmaus, and he appeared to the apostles at various times. In fact, we are told, we have read it already, that he appeared to 500 brethren at once. As I emphasized and explained last Monday, that is no hallucination, and that is no dream, and that is no trance. That is not just an apparition. 500 people, more than 500 people, cannot have the same dream, the same night, at the same time. 500 people, more than 500 people, cannot have a trance, an apparition, at the same time. He appeared in his risen form. He appeared in his glorified form to more than 500 brethren at once. The early church was certain The early church was sure. The early church was unshakable beyond any shadow of doubt that he rose from the dead. And you too, you have the assurance that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. And let's come to Mark chapter 16, and we're looking at verse 12. In Mark chapter 16, reading from verse 12, after that, he appeared in another form unto two of them as they walked and went into the city. Actually, that record is given to us in Luke chapter 24. In Luke chapter 24, it talks about, reading from verse 13, it talks to us about the two disciples, about the two brethren, and these two were going on their way to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 80 furlongs. Look at verse 14. In verse 14 it says, and they talked together of all these things that had happened. Was that of the arrest of Jesus? Was that of the crucifixion of Jesus? Was that of the burial, the death and the burial of Jesus? And now that they are hearing information that Christ has risen from the dead, that's what they were talking about. And then in verse 15, it says, and it came to pass that while they communed, while they spoke, while they discussed together, and the risen Jesus himself, there's another appearance now of Jesus Christ. Jesus himself drew near and went with them. Look at what happens in verse 16. In verse 16 it says, but their eyes were holding, their eyes were held up, their eyes were closed. They could not recognize him, that they should not know him. Look at verse 17. In verse 17 it says, and he said unto them, the risen Christ and the Christ who rose triumphantly from the dead now joined them. And he was going to ask them a question, what manner of communications are these that ye have one to another as ye walk and are sad? They were sad because they didn't know the Christ who rose from the dead, and the Christ they were thinking about, the Christ they thought was still dead, was still in the grave. And because of that, they were sad. He said unto them, what's the kind of communications you are having that makes you so sad as you are walking along? Look at verse 18. In verse 18, they said, and one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answering, said unto him, they didn't know it was Christ, said unto him, they didn't know that this is the risen one, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known the things which are come to pass there in these days? And Jesus was going to ask them, look at verse 19, in verse 19, and he said unto them, what things? He just wanted to, you know, engage them in conversation. He knew what they were talking about. He knew what they were thinking about. He knew the concern in their mind, and he knew their unbelief. He knew that they ought to have known that he rose from the dead, but their unbelief closed their eyes, and they said unto him concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, past tense, mighty indeed, and word before God and all the people. Look at what they said, they thought in verse 20. In verse 20, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death, and they have crucified him. Verse 21, in verse 21 it says, but we trusted, but we thought, but we believed in the past, we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel, which should have redeemed Israel. It's done it. It's paid the price of redemption, that he shall redeem all Israel from the iniquity. That's what he did on the cross. And that's why he rose from the dead now. And he's done it for you, he's done it for me, he's done it for everyone that will believe. And they said, we thought, we believed, we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. It's the third day since these things were done. And then it says in verse 22, yea, and certain women also of her company certain women also of our congregation, certain women also of our assembly, certain women also of our fellowship who believed with us, made us astonished, which were early at the sepulcher. Why were they astonished? In verse 23, it says, and when they found not his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he, the Christ, he, the risen one, he, the glorified Lord, he was alive. They were talking to Christ. They didn't know it was Christ. And he didn't stop them in their conversation. As they said, those women said, they testified, they saw a vision of angels. Not only that, the angels said he was alive. Verse 24. In verse 24, it says, and certain of them which were with us went to the sepulcher, and they found it even so as the women had said. But him they saw not. Look at verse 25. In verse 25, it says, then he said unto them, he was going to talk to them now, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. When he spoke like that, they just took him to still be a man and to be a preacher and to be a prophet. And he said, O fools, and they thought was just talking to them that you have not read your scriptures, you have not done this, you have not done that. He was speaking to them as somebody exhorting them, as somebody correcting them. But he had not revealed to them that he was the Christ yet, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Look at verse 26. In verse 26, they say, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? Read your scriptures. Ought not Christ to have suffered all these things and to enter into his glory? Recollect the words he spoke to you when he was alive. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? Look at verse 27. In verse 27 it says, and beginning at Moses, that is, beginning at the books of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, beginning at Moses and all the prophets, all the writings of the Old Testament, he was taking them from verse to verse, from chapter to chapter, and from book to book. And he said, he began at Moses and all the prophets and expounded unto them. He expounded unto them, he explained unto them, he interpreted unto them, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself, concerning Christ, about the suffering of Christ, about the betrayal of Christ, about the crucifixion of Christ, about the death of the Messiah, of the Christ, that will die and make an end of sin, about the redemption that will come as a result of that Christ who will suffer to take the sins of the world away. He expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Verse 28, in verse 28, and they drew near unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. After all, they were on their journey, and he joined them, and he counted him a stranger. And as they were now going to their house, he did as if he would go further. Verse 29, in verse 29, it says, but they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went to tarry with them. In verse 30, it tells us in verse 30, and it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them. The Lord Jesus Christ risen, the Lord Jesus Christ raised from the dead, the Lord Jesus Christ glorified. Now he was with them, and as was going to dine with them, he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and gave to them. That's exactly what he used to do. Do you remember when he fed the 5,000? He took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave to his own disciples to distribute to the crowd. Do you remember when he fed 4,000? He took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and then he gave to his disciples to distribute to the people that were waiting. He did exactly the same thing now. And you know, my brother, my sister, as we're studying the Word of God together, you'll see the consistency in the life of Jesus. Before his death, at his death, at his resurrection, after his resurrection, his life was the same, because it's always a life of goodness, a life of holiness, a life of righteousness, a life consistent with practice, the practice of the Word of God. Somebody asked a minister, he said, if you knew you would die today, what will you do differently? And the minister replied, he said, I'll just keep on doing what I am doing. Why? Because he was living right. Because he was living in the reality of the redemption and righteousness of the Lord. If you're expecting the Lord, you must allow every day to be a day of righteousness, a day of holiness. It's not like, you know, you hear the Lord is coming and then you are running helter-skelter. I need to adjust that. I need to adjust that. Why did you adjust that before? The Lord Jesus Christ did exactly what he had been doing before. He took the bread, he blessed it, and break it, and give it to them. Look at verse 31. In verse 31, and their eyes were opened. You couldn't eat with the risen Christ, and then your eyes will not be opened. You couldn't be blessed by the Lord Jesus Christ, and your eyes will not be opened. You couldn't listen to all those explanations and all the exposition of the Word of God from the risen Christ, and then sit at table with him and take the bread out of the hand of the risen Christ, and then your eyes will still be blind and will be closed. Immediately they got that bread, it says their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. Verse 32 tells us something very important. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures? Now they recognize that this is Christ. The Christ of Calvary, the Christ who rose from the dead, the Christ who rose for our justification and for our redemption, the Christ who has risen to give us all that we need. And that's point number one. That is the remarkable appearance of the risen Christ. We're coming to point number two now. Point number two is the restorative appearances of the risen Christ. He rose from the dead, and as he appeared to his own disciples, they were restored. And I pray that he will appear to you. Already you know that he rose from the dead, but his spirit can take the word of God and make the word of God alive in your soul, alive in your spirit, that afresh again you will see the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and it will bring renewal to you. Actually, the disciples did not readily believe the reports of his resurrection. However, they all became convinced after many infallible proofs that were read about in Acts chapter 1 verse 3, for the apostles and all the brethren, his post-resurrection appearances were restorative. His post-resurrection appearances were reassuring. He reassured them because of that resurrection. As you think about that resurrection, the disciples had known that Jesus rose from the dead. God raised Christ from the dead. Christ appeared in the risen, glorified body. The Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost quickened him. And the angels declared, they declared his resurrection. Even the unbelievers, those priests and those keepers, those guards, they exchanged a large amount of money to cover up the well-known resurrection. The apostles ate with the risen Christ. After he rose from the dead, you remember, he appeared to them and he asked them, children, have you any bread? And then they sat down and he ate with them, and he tells us very clearly that many brethren saw him, about 500. At the same time, they saw him after his resurrection. They all saw him at once. Christ's resurrection is undeniable. Christ's resurrection is unfalsifiable. You cannot fault it because it was real. Christ's resurrection is undebatable. And let's come to the scriptures as we look at Mark chapter 16, and I'm reading from verse 10. Mark chapter 16, we're reading from verse 10. And she went and told them that had been with him as they mourned and wept. There was still Christ had risen from the dead. The disciples had no reason to mourn now, and they had no reason to weep now. If they had recollected the words of Jesus Christ, on the third day, I will rise again. He said that in Matthew 2 times. He said that in Mark 2 times. He said that in Luke about 2-3 times. He said that in John about 2-3 times. And he said, he affirmed to them every time, the Son of Man will be betrayed into the hands of the Gentiles, and then they'll mock him, and they'll scourge him, they'll spit on him. He'll be killed, he'll be slain, but on the third day, he will rise again. If they recollected that, if they remembered that, if they brought that back to mind, there was no reason to mourn, and there was no reason to weep. But now, this Mary went to them and told them what she had seen. Look at verse 11. In verse 11, it tells us, and they, when they heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. She told them, Christ is risen. I saw him, and he appeared unto me. But they will not believe. Now we're told in verse 12. In verse 12, it says, after that, he appeared in another form unto two of them, as they walked and went into the country. That's what we read about in Luke chapter 24. And now in verse 13, it says, and they went and told it to the residue, to the people that were still remaining, neither believed they them. Those are the apostles. Those were the disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. This one told them, they believed not. Another one told them, they believed not. He's telling you something. They didn't just believe like that without being personally convinced, without being persuasively convinced that this Christ had risen from the dead. And the Lord allowed that to happen so that when eventually he appeared to them, it will be firm in their mind. And nobody will be able to erase that from their mind, that Christ had risen from the dead. Look at verse 14. In verse 14, it says, afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and he upbraided them. That means he rebuked them with their unbelief, because of their unbelief, and because of the hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. Actually, that restored them. That appearance of Christ, it was the restorative appearance of the risen Christ. Let's look at Matthew chapter 28. We're reading from verse 16. Matthew chapter 28, reading from verse 16. It says in verse 16, then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. You remember the message of the angel, go and tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee, as he had said unto you. Now he went to them, and he had this meeting with them. He appeared to them in Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. In verse 17, we're told, and when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Some still doubted. And it's now that he told them in verse 18, he said, all, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Risen from the dead, and death not to have dominion upon him anymore. He said, all power, all authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. No doubt he had risen from the dead. And let's look at John chapter 20. John chapter 20, we're reading from verse 24. And this tells you that as Jesus appeared unto the disciples, it was stage by stage. At the time he appeared to them, earlier in this chapter, in John chapter 20, Thomas was not there. And then he told Thomas that Christ had risen from the dead. And Thomas said, I don't believe that. You might believe. They had had all these women saying he rose from the dead. And they had had all the two witnesses, he rose from the dead. And Thomas now heard from the rest of the apostles, he rose from the dead. But Thomas, one of the 12 called Didymus, was not with them. When Jesus came, in verse 25, it says in verse 25, the other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. Think about that. I will not believe. Think about what he said. He said, except I see with the physical eyes, except I see with my natural naked eyes, and except I can see the print of the nails in his hand, and then on his side, I thrust my hand into his side, except all that will happen, I will not believe. What was he saying? Seeing is believing. Look at verse 26. In verse 26, after 8 days, again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, understand? Now he had glorified body, the risen body. He didn't have to knock at the door. He didn't have to open the door for him. The doors were shut. He says, the doors being shut, and Jesus stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. Verse 27, look at verse 27. Then says he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. Remember, Christ was not physically there with them. When Thomas said, except I put my finger in the nail prints, and except I thrust my hand to his side, I will not believe. And Christ came, he heard every conversation. He still hears every conversation. He knows the hardness of heart. He knows the unbelief of any heart today as at that time. Because nothing is hidden from the eyes of him with whom we have to do. He knows everything about us. He knows everything about you. What is said in the open, what is said in the secret, What is done in the open, what is done in the secret, the very thoughts of the heart, he knows everything. That's why as he came in now, he said, Thomas, come on here and touch me like you wanted to, and thrust your hand to my side like you wanted to, and be not faithless, but believing. Look at verse 28. In verse 28, and Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. Only the Lord can know my thoughts afar off, my Lord and my God. Only God can rise from the dead like that. This is not human. Nobody helped you and lifted you up by yourself, by your power, by all authority. You rose from the dead, my Lord and my God. I repent of my unbelief, my Lord and my God. I believe now with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my might, you are risen from the dead, my Lord, my God. If thou shalt believe in thine heart and shalt confess with your mouth that Christ rose from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And now Thomas believed that Christ rose from the dead and rose from for his justification, and he declared him to be my Lord and my God. In verse 29, Jesus says unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet believed. That's the blessing the believers of today. That's the blessing we have. We are blessed with salvation. We are blessed with reconciliation. We are blessed with regeneration. We are blessed with assurance of salvation. We are blessed with heaven, because we were not there and we didn't wait to see like Thomas. It says, blessed are they. Not only one person now, blessed are they in Israel, blessed are they among the Jews, blessed are they among the Gentiles, blessed are they in every generation, blessed are they in the time, the period, the generation of today. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. As we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that he died for you, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. As we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that he died for you and he rose again for your justification, and you declare what you believe in your heart, that Jesus my Lord, Jesus my God, Jesus my Savior, Jesus my Redeemer, died on the cross and rose for my justification, you are blessed with salvation. You are blessed with the grace of God. And then he tells us in verse 30, he says, and many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. In verse 31, it says, but these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life, everlasting life, ye might have life, eternal life, ye might have life, abundant life, ye might have life, the life of God in man, ye might have life, spiritual life, ye might have life, supernatural life, ye might have life, overcoming life, conquering life through his name. As you believe, then you have the life that comes through his name. We're coming now to point number three, the regenerating appearance of the risen Christ. The regenerating appearance of the risen Christ. And let me remind you that Jesus rose from the dead. After that, he appeared with many infallible proofs for 40 days to his own disciples. After the 40 days, then he went to heaven. And now, after he went to heaven and the disciples started preaching that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, persecution arose for the church. But they didn't mind because they knew they were telling the true story and the true revelation of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And now Christ was going to appear in his post-resurrection form unto a man that is called Saul of Tarsus. And now Christ appeared to him. You might have known the story. You have read the story. He was going on his way to Damascus. He was going to arrest the people that believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. All of a sudden, then the sun, there was a light brighter than the noonday sun. And he had a voice, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" And then the voice was coming from the sky. It was coming from above, coming from heaven. And Saul looked up and wondered, "Who are you, Lord?" And Jesus said, "I am Jesus, still alive." That's the risen Christ that appeared to him now. And he said, "What shall I do? I repent now. I turn around now. Everything I've done in ignorance, in darkness, and hardness of religion, the Jewish religion, I repent. I turn. I believe now that you are Jesus," and he took him for his Savior. Now in Acts chapter 9, verse 17, Ananias went his way and entered into the house and putting his hands on him said, "Brother Saul," the man was converted now. No more a persecutor, but he's going to become a preacher. He's no more the old persecuting creature, but now he's the new persuaded creature. He's a new creature in Christ. He's now a brother. He's now a member of the body of Christ. Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, the Lord, even Jesus. There was no doubt in the mind of Ananias. There was no doubt in the mind of Paul the Apostle. The Lord is not talking about Jehovah God Almighty. He's talking about Jesus, the risen Christ, the one who rose from the dead and appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, as sent me, that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. He had the appearance of Christ that was shown unto him. You see, the appearance of the risen Christ to Paul, who was Saul, brought conviction to him. It brought repentance to him. It brought faith in Christ. It brought forgiveness. All the sins he had committed because of that appearance of Christ, the risen Christ, and he repented, and he turned away, and he even surrendered his life to Christ, and said, "Lord, what will you have me to do?" And the Lord said, "Go to Damascus, go to the city, it shall be shown thee what thou shalt do." The man now abandoned the past project, and the past persecution, and the past programs, and his past passion. He abandoned everything with conviction, with repentance, and faith in Christ. He now went to Damascus, sins forgiven. And then he had assurance of salvation, and grace came to him for a new life, and then complete surrender of his life to the Lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what happened to him, and that is what happens to everyone today as the Lord appears to us in our heart. It's not by a physical vision, it is not by natural vision or trance, but now we read the word of God, the word of truth, the scripture of truth. As it appears to us now through the word, now we believe. And as we believe, regeneration comes to us. It was a regenerating experience for Paul the Apostle, as he was renewed, as he was transformed, and his soul and his spirit was totally transformed. Everything in his life changed for the better. Number one, his decision changed. Number two is devotion change. And number three is dedication to the Lord. Everything totally changed. Everything in his life, everything in your life too will change when you have this real encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything will turn around. Have you taken the decision? Have you had the conviction that Christ actually is risen from the dead, real encounter with the risen Christ brings, number one, repentance to us. Like Paul the Apostle, you will turn away from all the path of destruction you have been following before. It will bring reconciliation. Then it will bring restoration. If you have been a backslider, like when Peter denied the Lord, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, as he appeared unto Peter, appeared to the rest of the apostles, brought restoration. If you really believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that he rose from the dead and he rose for you, he rose for you to have the blessings of the kingdom. There'll be repentance, there'll be reconciliation, there'll be restoration, there'll be regeneration. Regeneration. Everything within in your mind, in your heart, in your life, in your behavior, in your character, the resurrection power of the Lord Jesus Christ will turn everything around. There will be redemption in your heart. There will be redemption of your soul and redemption of your total personality. There will be righteousness when we encounter this Lord Jesus Christ and he is risen. There will be righteousness. Revival will come. If you're lukewarm, if you're like sluggish, if you're like almost spiritually dying, almost dead, if you just have a name that you live, but you are dead spiritually, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, as you believe, actively believe, and you believe, positively believe, it will bring revival to you. It will bring renewal. Everything that is going kind of dormant and dirty and all that, renewal will come. There will be freshness in your life. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, that is what it does for us. And actually, as you keep on believing, even today, it's not just I believed in the past, but that faith in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ comes afresh and anew in your life. It will keep you ready for your own resurrection and keep you ready for the rapture on the final day. All this and all the other blessings of the new covenant through the power of his resurrection. That's why it's very important that you and I, that everyone believes in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to come to Romans chapter 1. We're reading from verse 4 and verse 5. Romans chapter 1, we're reading from verse 4. In Romans chapter 1 verse 4, and it says, and declare to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness. Look at this. By the resurrection from the dead. By that resurrection from the dead, Christ is declared to be the Son of God with power. In verse 5, it tells us in verse 5, it says, by whom we have received grace, grace for salvation, by whom we have received grace, grace for sanctification, grace for holiness, grace for righteousness, by whom, by that risen Christ, we have received grace, grace for service, grace for ministry, by whom we have received grace, grace for endurance, and grace for steadfastness until the very end. It is by that risen Christ, the power of his resurrection, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for the obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. It tells us in Romans chapter 6, reading from verse 4. Romans chapter 6, we're looking at verse 4. It tells us in verse 4 of Romans chapter 6, therefore, we're buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father. Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father. Look at this. Even so, we also should walk in newness of life, because we identify with him in his resurrection, as we identified with him in his crucifixion and in his death, in his burial. Now we are raised together with him. Even so, we also should walk in newness of life. Look at verse 6. In verse 6, it says, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and that henceforth we should not serve sin. Resurrection power that comes upon us makes us new. And now we think in a new way, we live in a new way, we behave in a new way, because the resurrection has had definite impact, reviving impact, restorative impact, righteous impact, and renewing impact upon our lives. Actually, it tells us in Colossians chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3, we're looking at verse 1. In Colossians chapter 3 from verse 1, it's now making the conclusion. It's saying, if ye then be risen with Christ. Now you are risen with Christ, you identify with Christ, not only in crucifixion, and not only in the death, and not only in the burial, but now Christ is risen from the dead. And he says, if ye be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Always think about the resurrection, and think on life after resurrection, and think of life after he rose from the dead, and see the difference between the risen Christ and the Christ that appeared natural to us, the man Christ, before he rose from the dead, before he was even arrested and crucified. You are now risen from the dead, and you are living on this side of Calvary. Resurrection power is working within you, and resurrection strength comes within you, in your soul, in your spirit, in your back, in your backbone. It says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Look at verse 2. In verse 2, it says, set your affection on things above. Don't look into the grave anymore. It's not there. And don't look at the dusty roofs of Nazareth or Capernaum or Jerusalem. It's not there. But now it's in heaven. It's seated on the right hand of power on high. Set your affection, and set your love, and set your passion, and set your desire on things above, not on things on the earth. Look at verse 3. This is beautiful. And it says, and ye are dead, and ye are dead, and your life is seed with Christ in God. Now you are protected. Nothing evil will touch your life. You are now on this side of the resurrection. And death will not have, premature death will not have power over you anymore. Any kind of a strange happening, remember now, you're on this side of Calvary. Do you remember that when Christ rose from the dead, Pharisees had no power? Pharisees could not do, could not injure him anymore. He came, he went through the closed door, he appeared unto them, power, a different kind of power, resurrection power, moved him around, and he says, now you are dead, and you are risen with Christ, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Thank God your life will be protected. Thank God your life will be preserved. And thank God the resurrection power of the Lord Jesus Christ will keep on moving in your life, and all the benefits coming from that resurrection will be yours in Jesus' name. And then as you move on until the day of his appearing, when he shall appear in glory, thank God you'll be ready. I said, thank God you'll be ready. Look at verse 4. It says in verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear. He's coming again. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, and when the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise, and we, which are alive, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to ever be with the Lord. Thank God you'll be there. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Before we round up and before we close, can you look at that verse and make that personal? When Christ, who is my life, shall appear, then will I appear also with him in glory. You'll make it in Jesus' name. You're saved. you're born again, you're a child of God, and your mind is to continue with the Lord until the end, between now and the end of the journey. All the grace you need, all the power you need, all the strength you need, all the enablement you need to live according as He wants you to live and to do the work He has committed into your hand. You will not fail. The grace of God will not fail in your life. Make it personal. Verse 4, when Christ, who is my life, shall appear, then will I appear also with Him in glory. I'll be waiting for that day. You are waiting for that day. And we'll see again face to face and we'll rejoice. That is grace. That is strength. That is redemption. That is power has brought us through. You'll go through in Jesus' name. Don't worry. Whatever you are going through now, that sin will not cut short your journey, because your life is hid with Christ in God through the Lord Jesus Christ. Is coming. When He comes, you'll be available, you'll be faithful, you'll be ready, you'll go with Him in glory. Let's rise up now and talk to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray that God Himself will help us to understand this message, hold on to this message, that He rose again. He rose up for you. He is risen because of you. And like Thomas, you can come from that side of unbelief and now say, my Lord and my God, my Lord and my God. Let Him appear to you in your spirit, in your conscience, in your soul, in your spirit, and affirm and believe He is my Lord, He is my God, and every benefit of His resurrection will be yours in Jesus' name. If you have not repented, repent of your sin, turn away from your sin, hold on to Christ, accept Him and receive Him as your Savior, my Lord and my God. And my brother, you are a child of God, remind yourself and remind heaven, He is my Lord, He is my God. And if you are sick, remember, it's the risen Christ who has brought us redemption, total redemption. And your sick body, it will heal. If you are down, if you are tired, if you are discouraged, that resurrection brings renewal to us, refreshing unto us, my Lord and my God. Whatever your needs are today, spiritually, emotionally, physically, naturally, and financially, this is the Christ who is your Lord, who will provide everything for you, my Lord and my God. That God will supply all your needs according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now set your affection on things above and not on things on the earth. Remember, always remember, your life is hid with Christ in God. And always remember the strength to move on, the grace to move on, the power to move on is available for you. All He has ordained for you to be, you will be. And His power will move you on. And when Christ, who is your life, shall appear, you also will appear with Him in glory. Be it all confirmed in your life in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Father, we thank You today. We bless Your name for the Bible study. Thank You for reminding us again that Jesus rose from the dead. And because He rose from the dead, now reconciliation is ours. Because He rose from the dead, regeneration is ours. Because He rose from the dead, restoration is ours. Because He rose from the dead, righteousness, the righteousness of faith is now ours. Because He rose from the dead, we know that total revival, the revival of our lives within, without, around, revival is ours. Because He rose from the dead, renewal is now ours. Because He rose from the dead, all it takes to be ready for our own final resurrection, all it takes to be ready for the rapture, You're going to do in our lives. lives. We pray that the power of the resurrection of Christ will work in our lives, and you quicken everything in our life, everything in our family, everything in our Christian profession, everything in all that you have appointed for us to do. And your power, the resurrection power, will not fail in any of our lives. In Jesus' name, Lord, we accept the revelation. We accept the declaration that all power in heaven and on earth, all authority in heaven and on earth is given unto you. We receive, we abide, we embrace that power and that authority, and your name you have given us will not fail in our lives. We pray, Lord, more victory, more conquering power you give to everyone, that joyfully, cheerfully, happily, we keep on walking now on this path of righteousness, because you rule on our behalf. And you rose again to finalize everything connected with our justification, our salvation, full salvation, as well as our total redemption. Let your blessing abide upon every life. And the benefit of this study today, let it continue in every life until we see you face to face in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.